Welcome one and all to this wonderful service, the induction of Wayne. Really looking forward to it. My name is Gary Bott. I'm one of the pastors here, and I just want to share a passage of scripture, to pray and to share some greetings. The first thing I want to do is pray. Father God, we thank you for this glorious day. We thank you, Father, for those that have travelled far and wide. And we thank you, Father, for the families that are represented here. Father, most of all, we want you to be welcome here. We know you are here. And we pray, Lord, that this service will be a blessing to your name as we see your kingdom come in Billericay. Father, I pray that you would bring your peace into our lives at this time on this day. In Jesus' name, amen. I wanted to read a passage of scripture, but before I do that, two greetings have come in for Wayne and for us as a church. Two previous pastors, Ian Smith and Alistair MacLeod, send their greetings to you, Wayne, and your family, and to us as a church as we embark on this new adventure, as we just prayed in there. I just think that's really exciting and lovely to hear from them. Let me read this psalm. Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever, and his faithfulness continues through all generations. Amen? Amen. Do we believe that, church? Yes. Amen. Roger, over to you. Or Joan, whoever it is.
That's okay.
Bless you.
It's really lovely to be leading the worship this afternoon. Nearly said morning, but I corrected myself. And I just want to point out that all the songs have been chosen by Wayne and his family. And this first little group, I believe, is down to the children. And I just want to add one verse to what Gary said, 1 Thessalonians 5. Rejoice always and delight in your faith, as it says in the Amplified Version. So let us stand and sing and give God our praise.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon. My name is Claire Blatchford. I'm one of the regional ministers for the Eastern Baptist Association, and it is my privilege to be back here at Billericay. Visit number three. It has been, January has been Billericay Baptist Church month for me, but it's great to be back and to conduct the induction of Wayne as pastor here. So we've gathered to induct a new minister, Wayne Dulson, to the work with the community of Christ here at Billericay Baptist Church. We come to affirm our belief that as this church and minister have explored the possibilities of life together here in Billericay, they have been brought to this mutual commitment through the movement and calling of God's Spirit. Today we've come to witness the covenant which this church and this minister are making with each other, to walk together as people of Christ. And we're going to hear from both the church and from Wayne as they share with us something of the story that's brought them both to this place today. And I'm going to invite Corinne, one of the leaders here at Billericay, to share the church's side of the story. Thanks, Corinne.
I'm very sorry, I've forgotten my badge. So I'm Corinne, and it's lovely to see so many of you here. Welcome. I'm sure I was standing in this place not very long ago, actually, welcoming Gary to become the Reverend Gary Bott. I've been given the privilege to tell you how, as a church, we sense God's calling for Wayne to join us as our church pastor. A few years ago now, we believed that God had told us, "See, I am doing a new thing." And as you know, that verse goes on to say, it's a refreshing and there will be streams in the wastelands. A very exciting promise. Then in 2021, not only were we coming out of COVID, but for various reasons, almost all of our ministry team left. And our now community pastor, Gary, was out of action undergoing significant cancer treatment. Certainly not the new thing any of us had expected. I would like to take this opportunity to again thank Roger, Mary, for the way you stepped up during what has been quite a difficult time, and to Graham Ross and Adrian Ward, who walked with us as our moderators. We use this time to pray, pause, and seek God's face. What was this new thing that God wanted of us? And were we actually open to it? We invited all of the church family to feed in words, pictures, scriptures, and thoughts, and nothing was ignored. We came to the conclusion that God wanted us to consider a new flat team structure, with each team member having responsibility for three specific areas that we had identified: our church family, internal, our communities, external, and the children and youth, with possible extensions to a family worker. Not sure how, but these became known as the in, the out, and the shake it all about. Wayne, if only you knew you were part of a holy hokey-cokey. Although team members would be wholly responsible and accountable for their own areas, we decided it would be wise to choose one of them to also take on the role of a team leader, ensuring all were pulling together in the same direction. All the roles were advertised through the BU settlement process and externally, and Wayne was the first person to apply for the BU through the BU for the role of internal minister. I don't know if I ever told you that bit. And as the internal minister, which does sound a bit medical, doesn't it? We have changed the name since. Although we were really excited by his profile, we'd previously come to the agreement that we would wait until the closing date, which was the end of May, before sharing all the profiles with our full search team, who in turn were also excited when they read Wayne's response. At the end of June, we held a round of Zoom calls with three possible candidates for that role, but it was only Wayne who got a unanimous thumbs up to move to a formal interview stage. There was such a sense of the Holy Spirit unifying us even through the laptop screen. I rang him straight away that evening to invite him for interview. He was thrilled, if a bit surprised, that I'd rung him so quickly. But it was clear that Wayne had the same sense of the Holy Spirit at work. And then the ease and candid nature of our conversation that evening reinforced our sense of unity. Things moved really quickly. Wayne's interview took place on the 16th of July, just 2 weeks after this Zoom call, as we wanted to try and fit it in before the school holidays. Our time together was easy and comfortable, even if you were a bit nervous, you said, even when we were discussing challenging topics. And Wayne was honest that he was also applying for the additional team leader role, as he felt that is where God was calling him. After our time together, the leadership remained behind to pray and discuss. There was such a buzz in the room that in some ways little discussion was needed, but we made sure we asked ourselves the key questions. We were unanimous that Wayne was the right man to introduce to the church for both roles, and that we should try and set up a preach with a view. Meanwhile, at our house, Wayne was meeting Gary. And so when I returned, it was obvious there was already a good chemistry between them and they were chatting away like old friends. Later that day, I asked Wayne if he would consider preaching with a view, and he wisely said he would allow things to settle over a couple of days and to have time to pray with Gemma. He later told me that he'd phoned Gemma on the way between the church and our house to say, I think we may have found a new church home. On the 11th of September, Wayne, together with the family, came to Billericay to preach with a view and then get interrogated over tea and cake. We discovered that the children had visited BBC before with other family members, where are they? And we all thought it was really funny because they knew the building, although Mum and Dad had never been. On the 21st of September, church members confirmed Wayne's calling and voted overwhelmingly to invite Wayne to become our church pastor, which the leadership then also extended to include the role of team leader. After speaking with his colleagues and elders at Cosham Baptist, we're delighted to say Wayne accepted our invitation. We agreed it would be ideal for the family to move to Billericay at the end of December. Therein lies another story for another day. This allowed them a full and proper family Christmas and to get used to their new home and for Kezia and Reuben to prepare for their new schools. We never know what lies ahead, but I just want to share this particular bit. During the moving process, one of the conversations that Wayne and I went like this. Corinne, I don't want you to think I'm a bit of a Welsh diva, but... I won't tell you what the topic was. Wayne, despite that, we are so looking forward to what the Lord may want to do with us and through us under your ministry as you, Gary, Roger, Mary, and whoever else the Spirit may lead us to, seek to bring us into that new freedom of the Holy Spirit, and together may we introduce many more to a personal relationship with our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Thanks so much, Corinne. As you feel like I need to say now, please stand and please get in a big circle and let's do the hokey cokey. That would be great, wouldn't it? Perhaps we'll do it at the end, the after show party. Well, let's hear from Wayne and let's hear his side of the story of what's brought us here today. Thanks, Wayne.
Thanks, Claire. Good afternoon. Before I start, I've just had a text from a very good friend of mine from my home church in South Wales, in Griffithstown Baptist Church, saying that they're watching on YouTube and to pass on their greetings. He's a bit late to the party as it started, but I think as he heard Gary bring greetings from somebody else, he thought, oh, I better get in there as well. So greetings to you from Griffithstown Baptist Church in South Wales. This is fun, isn't it? There are family members here, there are friends here, there are church family here. It's a bit like a wedding without the expense, isn't it? That's what it's like. But as a family of four, we do want to thank you all for making time in your diary to either come here today or to watch it online. I know there's some friends in Alabama in the US are watching it as well, so it's lovely to see you guys as well. It means a lot to us that you've decided to give up your Saturday afternoon But I know the Rugby Six Nations hasn't started yet, so that's why some of you are here, but you wouldn't be if it was next weekend. It's also a bit strange, as my role now is to share how I came to sense God was calling me and Gemma and Kezia and Reuben to come to Billericay. You may think, well, why is that strange? Well, for us it's strange because, in one sense, as I often say to some people, this is not my first rodeo, and that means that to come here, I had to leave somewhere else. And a number of them are sat here today. It can feel a bit like you've ended one relationship, you're saying how great this new relationship is, but the old relationship is still sat right by there. But in all seriousness, I think we need to view this differently. For this is about God's church with a big C. It's about his kingdom. And so this is all part of God's plan, not just for me and my family, not just for Billericay Baptist Church, but I believe for Caution Baptist Church also, and we'll hear from them in a moment or two. I was ordained a Baptist minister in 2001. Yes, I know I was only 10. It's a long time ago. And my first church was Upminster, and it's great to see some of them represented here today. I then moved to Loughton in 2005. And again, it's wonderful to see some of them from that congregation here today also. And we felt called to Caution and moved there in January 2019. And both Gemma and I felt fairly early on in our stage there, that we didn't know why. We truly felt called by God to Caution in Portsmouth, but we felt that we wouldn't be there for a long time, whatever that would mean. We heard from God separately to say that we were passing through. And I was hoping that didn't mean that one of us was passing through to heaven just yet, especially as I was quite ill at the time. So when I felt it was right for us to consider if God was calling us on from Caution, as part of the discernment process, I met with my regional minister, who at the time was Joff Hunt, known to some of you because Joff and Sue, I think, used to be members here at one point. I entered what we would call the settlement process. Sounds a bit painful, doesn't it? And I started to see where God was calling me. Now, during this time, I spent many moments chatting with Tim, who will be sharing what God has placed on his heart a little bit later. Tim's a good friend of mine who we met in Zambia back in 2016. And Tim is someone who understands the Bible and theology far better than I ever will. And over breakfasts and pub lunches, we chatted and prayed, and he truly helped me discern what God was saying to me. So thank you, Tim, for that. There are a number of churches that seem suitable, and I met with some leadership teams both online, praise God for Zoom, and in person. It can feel a little bit like a dating site, but I'm not sure which way you're supposed to swipe, as you see in these different churches. These weird first dates all went well and were all good experience, but something wasn't clicking for me. Something wasn't quite right. I saw Billericay was what we call in the trade on the list, and I spoke with my wife about it and said, I'm not sure I'm right for them. I don't think I'm what they're looking for. And in all honesty, I said, I'm not sure I have what it takes to be their minister. So I didn't apply. So I left it. And a really good friend of mine who's a Methodist minister once said to me many years ago, he said these words, if I'm trying to work out if God is saying something to me or nudging me in a certain direction, I leave it for a while. And if I find I keep coming back to it and I can't put it down, I usually know that God is saying something to me. And very simply, guys, that's what I did with you. I just put you to the side. For some reason, I couldn't put Billericay down. And every time I looked at the list, there was Billericay staring me in the face, saying, choose me, swipe left or swipe right, whatever it is. Also, Gemma and I had no real interest in coming back to Essex. Now, I need to qualify that. There's nothing wrong with Essex. But Billericay is fairly close to Upminster, not a million miles from Loughton, and we weren't sure if we needed to explore other areas geographically. But even with all of that, I just couldn't put it down. So we decided I would send my profile and I would apply and just see what happens. Long story short, Billericay contacted me, to say I've been shortlisted and could I have an initial meeting one evening on Zoom. So we set this up, and one evening we have our Zoom meeting. At the time, my office, my desk was in our dining room, so Jem could hear my, I had my headphones in, Jem could hear my side of the conversation when she was in the living room, but she couldn't hear anything else. So she could hear, whether there was laughter or whether there was silence or whether I was talking seriously or talking easily. In that first meeting, as Corinne said, there was a real sense of the Holy Spirit and of God moving, and all seemed to go well, and I was told they'll speak to me. To those as well that weren't at the meeting, and they get back to me hopefully within about 2 weeks. I came out of the dining room, walked into the living room where Jem was and said, well, that was good. That seemed to go well. Well, the 2 weeks wait for Billericay to get back to me turned out to be around 45 minutes. As around 10 p.m. that evening, my phone rang with a number I didn't recognize that I almost didn't answer. And Jem said, well, you better answer it. And it was Corinne saying they'd like to meet me in person for a full interview. Now, this might not seem like anything to many of you, but as someone who's been in ministry for 22 years, it doesn't usually happen like that, as churches are notoriously known for deliberating and taking longer than we need to, a bit like this retelling of the story for me. But at that point, I knew God was in it. I went to Billericay one Saturday afternoon and had an interview. I knew God was doing something. As I said to Corinne, I was quite nervous. There was something going on inside of me that meant this was quite a big deal. After the interview, I phoned my wife and said, I think God may have just found us a new church, but I didn't want to tell them that straight away. That was in July. We then had this period of a few months till I came and preached with a view in September, and it was evident to us that God was calling us to Billericay. And so when they phoned a couple of weeks later to say, after the church members meeting and a vote, they'd invited me to come here as the minister, I had no hesitation, as I knew God was in this. One of the confirming factors for me was the verse that the church had been working through for quite a while now, from Isaiah 43, where God says, forget the former things. See, I am doing a new thing. I've been privileged and blessed to have been a minister in different and varied churches. This has given me different and varied roles and experiences, and it's been wonderful. And for me, through all of this, this verse God was speaking to me has been there. And I felt God was saying, you've been where I've wanted you to be for the times I've wanted you to be there. You've had some great times, yes, some tough times, yes. But through it all, you've had a blast. And you have grown as a minister, but more importantly, you've grown as a child of God. But I'm going to do something new that will be unlike anything you've ever known. You see, as a Christian and as a minister, it has always been and always will be simply about doing what calls me to do. A good friend of mine at my induction in Cosham said, some people think, they often say to him, is it hard being a minister, knowing what God wants you to do? He said, it's very simple. You just do what God tells you to do. Nothing more and nothing less. Even when it seems difficult, uncomfortable, easy, or anything else. As long as we simply walk in the ways God lays before us, then eventually, as we just sang, all will be well. And so I'm so excited and pleased to now be here in Billericay. Being a Welshman and my wife being from Essex, we are now truly Gavin and Stacey, only the other way around. I'm not sure yet if Gary is Smithy, but we'll find that out as we go along. He could be, couldn't he? He really could. I am now always going to call you Smithy, you know that, don't you? But I believe God has some great plans for the time ahead, and I'm blessed to be walking this next part of my journey with you here at BBC. But I do want to say some thank yous as I close. To Cosham Baptist Church, thank you truly for being part of my journey. We really miss you. I miss sharing with Simon and Vanessa and Sam and Richard and the wider leadership team. Sharing with them and the church that I was going to be leaving was one of the hardest moments in my ministry. Because after being there for only 4 years, I knew it would be difficult to hear. But I learned so much in my 4 years with you and believe that God has great plans for you also. And I'm so pleased that there's so many of you here today, probably to make sure that I was definitely gone, but it's good that you're here. And even if you don't feel like it, you are part of this journey. To Billericay Baptist Church, thank you for the way you have welcomed us as a family and made us feel at home. We've only been living in Billericay for 6 weeks yesterday. But someone said something last Sunday, so that's only 5 weeks in, and I think the words were, you seem to have slotted in so naturally, it feels like you've been here forever. I think it was meant as a compliment. Only time will tell. I do have that effect on people. To Jem, Kez and Rubes, you are all awesome. You will find out that they are awesome. I could not do what I do without you and your support. I do not have enough words in my vocabulary to tell you how much I love you. And I know this move has not been easy for you, but you have been awesome. And as a family, we have seen how God has made things go smoothly for us. We have that photo, don't we, that print that says, On Adventures with God. And that is our family motto. And you've chosen to come on this adventure with your mad dad as well. And I appreciate that. But today, ultimately, the main thanks go to God, who is still working and moving in people's lives. And for reasons that I still don't fully know or understand, he decided to call me into ministry many years ago. And he's given me the awesome privilege of coming here as the new church pastor of Billericay Baptist Church. And as pastor and church, we're going to have a blast. Thank you.
What a great story. What a great story. I'm going to invite Simon Ford, who is pastor at Cosham, who's going to bring greetings on behalf of the church family there.
Thank you. Well, first of all, greetings from Cosham Baptist Church. And it's interesting because Wayne sent me an email and said, would you like to be part of this service? I thought, is that normal? And then he sent me what it was, this greetings and support. And I thought, and so this is what I actually said to Wayne. I said, is that like being father of the bride? And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, well, it is in a way, isn't it? Because we're saying every blessing from our family, and we... No, I don't want to say willingly give you away. I should have thought about this. No, but it is that thing that we want to say that, yes, it's been, you know, it's been great to be part of your adventure and for you and your family to be part of Cosham Baptist Church. And as a church, as an individual, as with my wife and the leadership team and the church, I think we do recognise that God is leading you on his adventure. And of course, we recognise that our God is bigger than any one church. Our God is bigger than any one part of the country or part of the world. And so we support you and support this church in this new adventure. And we want to continue to pray for you all, continue to pray that you will grow, your family will grow. It's been such a delight. I've mainly worked with the youth and children. It's been great to have Reuben and Kez part of the youth ministry and seeing them grow. And so we just pray blessing upon you and upon this church. And yes, we do give you away and we do support you. Praise. Bless you.
So Wayne, if you come and join me on the platform, I have a question to ask Wayne, then I have a question to ask Gemma, and then a question to ask Kezia and Reuben, and then it will be over to you as minister and church make promises to one another. So it is like a wedding. I think, yeah, very much so. So thank you. Wayne, as you serve within this church community, will you commit yourself to both giving to its members and to receiving from them as members of the body of Christ? Will you lead and serve this fellowship in your calling as a pastor, seeking the kingdom of God and always following our Lord Jesus Christ, who is head of the church?
as a disciple of Jesus Christ and in the power of the Spirit, I will.
Fantastic. Gemma, come and join us.
Kids, do you want to come up as well?
Yeah, you might as well. That'll... Okay, so Gemma, you've just heard the commitment that Wayne has made to this church. Do you promise to encourage and support him as he seeks to exercise his ministry in this church and community?
As a disciple of Jesus Christ and in the power of the Spirit, I will.
Good news. So, Kezia and Reuben, we know that it's not just your dad who has moved here to Billericay, but that you've moved as a family. We want to thank you for that and ask that you support your dad and make sure he doesn't work too hard. If he does, tell Corinne and she'll tell me. And that he has some fun times at home with you both. Will you pray for him and ask God to help him in all of this?
We will.
Super, super. So if you are a member here at Billericay, or you find your home here, you worship here regularly, can I ask you to stand now if you are able? Some words will appear on the screen and invite you to read the words in the mustardy, yellowy, browny colour. I don't really know how to describe that colour, but it's all on the screen for you. Over to you, Wayne.
As we say these words together, really think about what we're saying. They speak of this new covenant that we make to each other before God. Today we stand with each other. Affirming our faith in the God who loves us with a love that transforms us.
And who calls us to work for a transformed world.
Today we stand with each other.
Recognizing the Christ in each other.
Affirming the calling of the Spirit.
Who has brought us together this day.
Today I bring myself and the gifts I have and I covenant to share and encourage this church and community.
To respect and care
for you, to journey with you, to take responsibility among you, to seek God with you, to listen to God in you, and to work with you to be Christ in this world. Now it's your turn.
Yeah.
Today we bring ourselves and the gifts we have, and we covenant to serve this church and community, to respect and care for each other, to take responsibility for the people we are and the people we hope to be in Christ, and to encourage you as our minister as we make this journey together.
What kind of people does Christ call us to be?
We are called to be a prophetic people, working for justice, resisting violence, and challenging the abuse of power. We are called to be an inclusive people, pulling down the walls of prejudice and welcoming the stranger. We are called to be a sacrificial people, risking uncertainty, becoming vulnerable, and reflecting the generosity of God. We are called to be a missionary people, demonstrating in word and action the redeeming love of God in the world. We are called to be a worshipping people, seeking and celebrating the God who journeys with us and open to the Spirit in the whole of life.
God of life, you call us and envision us. We give ourselves today to each other and to you, trusting that as you call us, so you covenant to share this journey with us, to nurture and sustain our life together, and to guide our paths. Amen.
Amen. And can I ask everyone else who's here this afternoon to stand up too, if you're able. So as friends and representatives of the wider church and community, we've heard this church and minister affirm their faith and make a covenant with each other and with God. If you will recognise and support this new relationship, they invite you to say the words on the screen now. Today we stand with you, recognising the commitment you have made. offering our encouragement for the challenges ahead and sharing in your hope for a new day. Amen. Please be seated. We're now going to pray for Wayne, knowing that he can't do this all on his own. And we really ask for God's just guiding hand and strength in the weeks, months and years ahead. So if I can have Simon and Vanessa, Tim, Dave, Corin, Ruth and Gary, or anybody else that Wayne may have invited you to come forward and hasn't told me. But I think that's it. And yeah, Gemma and Kezia and Reuben. If you want to stand in the middle. So let us pray. Merciful God, whose steadfast love is renewed every morning, we give thanks for this day of new beginnings in the life of Wayne, Gemma, Kezia and Reuben, and for this new chapter in the story of this church, your church. Lord, you've led pastor and people together, guiding them by your spirit, and we ask that your guiding and strengthening hand will remain upon them as together they enter this covenant partnership with you for the sake of the gospel. For Wayne, we pray that you will renew within him the gifts and grace of your Holy Spirit, that he may lead a life worthy of the calling of Jesus Christ. So fill him with your spirit, I pray, that he may lead those committed to his charge in proclaiming the gospel of Jesus, and together with all your people, serve Christ and his world in all compassion and faithfulness. Lord God, fill him with wisdom, understanding and strength. Keep from him all evil, error, arrogance and self-seeking, that he may set the believers an example in conduct, speech, love, faith and purity. And for your church here in Billericay, we pray that the mutual love and trust expressed today might grow through all the possibilities and changes of this life. Lord, help all who gather here in the name of Jesus to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, that together they might become for all to see a letter of Christ written with the Spirit of the living God. Loving God, prosper all that is the work of your Spirit here, that the members of this church may be blessed and given to your world in costly service and fruitful ministry to your praise and your glory. And I ask it in the name of our Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Amen. And those of you to pray as well, please.
Father, we thank you that you've brought Wayne and Gemma and Kezia and Reuben to this day at this place, Lord. We thank you so much for them. We pray that you would fill them with your spirit. Mm. Lord, we ask for your protection over them, your protection over their marriage, their family, for their ministry here. Lord, we pray your blessing and fruitfulness for the glory of your name and the sake of the gospel. Mm. Amen. Amen.
Yeah, Father God, we just bless you for this man. We bless you for Wayne. We're so excited for what you're going to do. But God, I just really acknowledge before you that we know that is one step in front of another, that is one foot in front of another, that is exactly what you are putting in front of Wayne and in front of us as a church at that time. And we just bless you for that. We trust you for that. I pray for Wayne that he would have big faith. Mm. And I pray for us as a church too that we would have big faith.
Amen.
Not to do
Amen.
What we can do, but to do what you can do. And for Gemma and for Kezia and for Reuben as well, God, I just so bless you for this awesome family. They are awesome because you've brought them together. You've made them. And Father, I pray that they would continue just to settle in well, to have your peace, and that you would give them really fun, good things to do while they are here with us. Father, you've got such good plans for their lives, and we pray your will be done, your kingdom come.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Father, to both of us, you gave those words, see, I am doing a new thing, and I pray that this season we will see some fulfillment of that promise most especially the streams in the wilderness, new growth springing up. And we ask, Lord, that we would work this in your timing, in your places, in your way, and anoint Wayne and the rest of the team with Gary, Roger, Mary. Lord, we thank you for them. And the rest of us as church, let us be all one, Holy Spirit, knowing a new time of just freedom in you. Anoint this time and this season. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just wanted to share some scriptures which I feel that the Lord's put on my heart for you guys, for Rubes, the good work that God has started, he will bring to completion. For Kezia, fear not, says the Lord, because I am with you. For Jem, have no anxiety about anything. And for Wayne, scripture from Proverbs that just says this, it says, keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Mm. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Yeah, Father God, we just pray and thank you for the blessing that they've been at Caution. And for the friendship that we've had together. And we just pray that you will bring new friends, that you will bring good friendships and true friendships, Lord, that you will bless Kezia and Reuben as they start their schools, and that they will find their true friends that will be blessed by you, Lord. We just thank you that you've given them a new home to move into and ask that you bless that home. Amen.
Amen. And Lord, I pray for this new team, for Wayne, for Gary, for Roger and for Mary. Lord, that you would bind them together. Lord, that they might be of one mind and the mind of you, Lord Jesus. Lord, may they have vision that will be from you. Lord, give them fun, give them laughter. But most of all, may they see things that they could never have imagined seeing. Lord, may they dream big and may they see incredible things in the time ahead. And Lord, for the elders and the trustees, Lord, all who will serve and support them in all that they do, Lord, bless each one of them, strengthen them when they feel weak, and give them courage when they feel less than courageous. For in Jesus' name we ask, and to you we give all the honour and the glory. Amen.
Amen.
If you all want to take a seat, Wayne, you can stay there. Fantastic. So in the name of Jesus Christ and his church here at Billericay Baptist, and in the name of the Baptist Union of Great Britain, I now declare that Wayne Dulson has been inducted to the pastorate of this church and congregation to work with them and they with him in the ministry to which Christ has called them all. And I offer you the right hand of fellowship.
Nice and formal.
Fantastic. There's some more words that are going to appear on the screen as we pray just a final blessing over Wayne and the church here. So let's say together. The covenant God binds you in grace and love. The faithful God keep you faithful through all things. And the God of hope and peace sustain you in the way of Jesus this day and every day. Amen. Billericay Baptist, your new minister.
going to sing two songs now. So if you'd like to stand, and I just want to encourage you, if you're not too familiar with either one of these, that you allow the words to minister to you. Worship without singing, it's okay if you're not 100% certain of these songs.
Thank you.
But I'm going to invite Sue and Richard, who are going to come and read the Bible readings that have been chosen for this afternoon.
Good afternoon. My name's Richard, my wife Sue. I'm the secretary of Cosham Baptist Church. And thank you for welcoming us here today. Thank you also to the band who played wonderfully in leading us in worship. The first reading is from 2 Timothy 1, verses 16 to 14. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and has called us to be a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Saviour, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the Gospels. And of this Gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed and am convinced that he is able to guard what I've entrusted to him until that day. What you heard from me, keep us the pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Jesus Christ. Guard the good deposit that has entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us.
And the second reading is from Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, to the church in Ephesus. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among you the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you first had. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Amen.
Well, good afternoon. How are we all doing today? As Wayne said, we first met in Zambia a number of years ago. I was out there working and the Dulsons came out to visit for a few weeks as part of their sabbatical. And we quickly connected and became really good friends. And I think ever since then, we've kind of come together for a meal or breakfast or something like this and just massively value those times as well. You know, you become like a brother to me, Wayne. And so it's a massive privilege to be here today on this day of your induction, Wayne, and to celebrate with you, friends and family, and Billericay Church here together. When I started thinking and praying about this afternoon a few weeks ago, I actually ordered you a little gift, Wayne, but unfortunately it hasn't arrived yet. So I'm really sorry about that. I'm going to have to post it to you when we get back sometime. I did chase them up the other day, and I'm sure that it's on its way. But I think the reason it hasn't arrived is because it's a book, and it's I don't think it's even properly published anymore, so they had to get it imported from somewhere else. And it's written by a guy called Jack Miller, who's died now. And Jack Miller was not a hugely influential pastor. Most of you, I'm sure, will never have heard of him. But he led a church for a number of years. And this church, they sent out people to plant other churches. And they sent out missionaries around the world. And Jack, over the course of his ministry, would write to the church planters who he'd sent out. He'd write to the missionaries that they'd sent out. And after he died, his wife collected these letters that he had written to all these kind of people around the world and collated them into this little book, Letters from Jack Miller. And for me, it's a massive encouragement to see one seasoned, experienced pastor writing to younger pastors, missionaries, encouraging them in their journey, exhorting them to be faithful in their ministry to Christ and those who they are called to serve. And so for me, it's a massive encouragement, and I really hope that I would be able to give that to you today, Wayne. But I'm just going to have to wait for that, and I'll send it to you. But here's the reason why I mentioned that, because as we thought today about these verses from 2 Timothy, that's kind of similar as to what's going on there. Paul, this seasoned pastor, Paul, this seasoned missionary who's been traveling around for years, preaching the gospel, writing to the younger pastor, Timothy, who is in Ephesus, struggling in difficult circumstances. 2 Timothy is one of my favorite letters in the whole of the New Testament, not least because it's named after me, but I think because it's got that tender advice from one seasoned pastor to a younger pastor who's kind of growing up and discovering more of his calling and gifting and these kind of things. But also it's probably the last letter that we have of Paul before he died. He knows that he's about to face death. And so these are the kind of, in 2 Timothy, we have the kind of last words of Paul before he is eventually martyred. And he writes tenderly to his apprentice, Timothy, who is struggling and wrestling with being a pastor in Ephesus. Now, at that time, in the Roman world, Ephesus is one of the biggest cities, one of the four major cities of the Roman world. There's over 250,000 people live there. And around this time, of all the places that Paul visited during his Gentile mission, he spent the most time in Ephesus, had a special place in his heart. But it's also a difficult place to be a Christian. It's a difficult place to worship the true God. We've got, some of you all know that one of the seven wonders of the ancient world was the temple to Artemis, which is there in Ephesus. Ephesus isn't a city anymore. It was eventually the harbour there. It's on the kind of Turkey, the west coast of Turkey, and the harbour silted up and it was the city was abandoned. We also know from Acts 19 that this was a place in Ephesus where the craftsmen were threatened because Christianity and the introduction of Christianity in this city threatened the kind of temple worship and, you know, threatened the trade of these craftspeople who made their living building and creating idols. And it's in that kind of context that Paul writes to Timothy. And I've got really 3 points that I want to draw out of the passage that was read to us from 2 Timothy just there. I did have 5 points, but then I remember that we were coming to a Baptist church, so cut it down to 3, just for you, Wayne. And really all around this idea that where we look determines how we walk. Now, most of the time, we don't pay any attention to the way that we walk. We just kind of walk nonchalantly along. But if you've got to walk over difficult terrain or you've got to walk over something narrow, then you have to start paying attention. You have to look carefully where you are walking. And then if you've ever noticed a tightrope walker, those who have to be ultra careful about where they're walking, where do they look? Dead ahead. If you've ever watched a tightrope walker, they're looking dead ahead. My wife Helen's here with me today, and she told me that a little while ago, she was given the advice when she was cycling uphill that actually, if you're cycling uphill and you look down, you can trick yourself into feeling that you're actually cycling along the flat, so it makes it a little bit easier. This is advice that she dutifully followed as she cycled into a parked BMW. Where you look determines how you walk. And here in 2 Timothy, I think we have three keys that Paul is giving his young apprentice for ministry, for life as he serves the church there. Look to the calling, look to the gospel, and look to the future. Earlier in this chapter, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, Paul is reminding Timothy of the legacy of faith that has been handed down to him. He references Timothy's mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois. He reminds Timothy of the laying on of hands, as we've done with Wayne and the family this afternoon. In verse 9, Paul reminds Timothy that we are called to live a holy life. We have this sense of calling. We have this sense of being responding to God's initiative of calling us. It's interesting, isn't it, that in most instances in the Bible where God calls somebody, their response is, no, not me, God. I couldn't do that. You know, that actually there's a bit of coaxing required by God. Think of God's call on Moses in Exodus chapter 3 in the burning bush. Think of God's call to Jeremiah. And he's like, Jeremiah says, I didn't want to follow this. I didn't want to be a preacher, but his word was like fire in my bones. There's this kind of response, God, I can't do it. You see, if our calling, if the calling of God on our lives doesn't give us pause to fear, it's probably a human dream rather than a God-sized vision. And our reaction, I think, can often be so telling. If our reaction to a call or something that we sense God is saying is, yeah, I can do that, then it's we've probably not heard the full extent of what God is wanting to call on our lives. We probably haven't grasped this. Why? Because I think God wants to do things in and through you and me in a way that he gets the glory, so that we don't get to the end of fulfilling our calling when one day, by the grace of God, we hear, well done, good and faithful servant. But we don't get to that day and say, look at what I did. We get to that day and we say, look at what God did. The calling is big, that he gets the glory, that we have to rely on him. We don't enter our call. Wayne doesn't enter the call of being a pastor here with all his needs met already, because that doesn't require faith. There's so many things, I think, that seek to distract us, divert us, pull us away from the sense of God's call on our lives. Corrie ten Boom, the Dutch writer and a theologian, she said, if the devil can't make you sin, he'll make you busy. And we face in our lives constant distractions and diversions from God's call over our lives. And by the way, for all of us, the primary call is first and foremost to Jesus. First and foremost is our primary call. You remember the story of Mary and Martha in Luke chapter 10, where Martha's busying herself doing lots of things for Jesus, you know, diverting from the true. And what Jesus says to Mary, you have chosen the great thing, to sit at my feet and to learn. Our primary calling is always to Jesus. So many things want to divert us, distract us away from this. Now, some of you here may be thinking, this is great for Wayne, and it's great for Gary, whose induction was a couple of weeks ago, whenever, right? This is great for them, who get a whole service celebrating their calling. But what about me? What about my calling in the workplace or in the home or in the school or whatever it might be? Or what if, you know, I don't know that I have a sense of call on my life? And to you, I say this, if you're in Christ Jesus, you have a call on your life. And I know that because in Ephesians chapter 2, this very kind of same church that Paul spoke to when he first kind of founded it so many years earlier, in Ephesians chapter 2, he tells us that you are God's workmanship, created in advance to do good works. And that word workmanship is the Greek word poema, from where we get the word poem. It's like you're God's work of art. He has a unique call on your life, a unique job that only you can fulfill. And if you don't know what that is yet, and you want to know, then you need to come and talk to Wayne or Gary, because they'll help you discern. I guarantee that, because I know there's a real joy in pastoral ministry. One of the real joys is helping other people to discern their call, right? And to see them released in the fullness of what God has for them. And that's part of what, you know, Wayne and Gary, these guys, that it's part of what their job is, help you find your call. So if you don't know what that is yet, you come and talk to them and pray with them and seek God together. Number two, look to the gospel. One of the things that I love about the pastoral epistles, and the pastoral epistles are those letters that Paul writes to individuals, to people like Timothy, Titus, encouraging them in their ministry, is unlike some of his other writings where Paul more systematically sets out the gospel and then more systematically sets out what our response to the gospel should be. In the pastoral epistles, you get much more of a sense that Paul, he's giving practical advice about how to lead churches and how to choose elders and all these kind of things that we get bogged down with in ministry. But in the midst of that, he keeps calling them back. He keeps calling Timothy and Titus back to the centrality and the importance of the gospel. He keeps calling them back over and over again, emphasizing the importance of the gospel, of our reconciliation with Christ. You know, my brother-in-law is a farmer, and you're about to learn that I have very little farming knowledge. But in Devon, where my brother-in-law farms, when you want to keep the cattle in a field, what you do is you put hedges. In fact, they're probably already there, because most of the hedges in Devon are like over 700 years old. And that's true, by the way. That's not an exaggeration. Many of them are like really, really old. And to keep the cattle in the field, what you do is you hedge them in. Now, I was reading recently, there's a farm in Australia, a cattle ranch in Australia, that is almost the size of Belgium. Now, Anna Creek Station, look it up or Google it later. Now, a farm that size, you can't hedge in all of the cattle. You've got tens of thousands of cattle and you can't hedge them in like that. What do you do instead? You sink boreholes. You give a place for nourishment. You give a place for refreshment. And the cows keep in their area that they're supposed to be in because they keep coming back to the source. And that's the kind of impression that I think you get when you read a letter like 2 Timothy. In the midst of all the pastoral advice and the ministry concrete practical advice that Paul gives to Timothy, he's like, keep coming back to the source. Keep coming back to the truth. And there is a necessity for us, whether you're in full-time ministry or not, to keep coming back to the reality and the truth of the gospel. And Paul has set this out for us so clearly, I think, in Ephesians chapter 2, that you were dead in your sins. You were objects of the wrath of God, dead in your sins and trespasses. But God, it says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, but God. And everything in human history pivots on those two words. This is what you were. You were dead. You were following the prince of the air. You were, this is who you were, but God in Christ. Not through anything that you could do, says Paul, but through the great love with which he has loved us. Poured out grace upon our lives. He's made us alive to be with Christ, reconciled to him forever. This is the good news of the gospel. And it's absolutely important that we as Christians remind ourselves regularly. Charles Spurgeon, he's a great Baptist preacher, wasn't he? You know, said, he preach the gospel regularly to yourself first. Remind yourself, I am more and more convinced that what gives us resilience in ministry is our interior life before God. What gives us resilience and the motivation in our life and calling, whether that's in church, whether that's at home, whether that's in school, whatever that means, what gives that the resilience and the perseverance to keep going and to keep following Christ is that interior life before God, regularly reminding ourselves of the gospel, regularly reminding ourselves at the truth of our union with Christ, our adoption as sons of God, regularly reminding ourselves the truth that in Christ I have nothing left to earn, nothing left to prove. And because of that, I can minister freely, openly. We preach the gospel first to ourselves. And then finally, look to the future. To the future, Paul reminds us here in 2 Timothy 1, verse 12. He says he looked to the future until that day. Connects this with his suffering. He's suffering until that day. If I'm totally honest with you, one of my concerns for the Western church is also one of the concerns for my own life, that there is a drift towards the temporary. There is a drift towards what is observable, what I can see right in front of me now. There's a drift towards the temporary. And when we have a lack of eternity in our hearts, when we have a lack of eternal perspective, I think that results in a couple of negative impacts. One of those would be a lack of missional impulse. When there's a lack of eternity, there's a lack of the necessity to share the gospel of Christ. There's a lack of missional impulse. And two, when there's a lack of eternal perspective, there's a lack of willingness to suffer, right? Because all I can see is what's in front of me, what's here and now. You know, we sometimes accuse people of being too heavenly minded to be of any earthly use. And I understand what that phrase means. You know, we find people annoying who are all kind of pie in the sky kind of things like that. But actually, I think the reverse is true. Actually, I think the reverse is true, that if we are heavenly minded enough as we should be, then that makes us of the utmost earthly use. Because then we have a missional impulse. We have a willingness to suffer for the sake of Christ. When we look to the future, when we look to the eternity that Christ has prepared in advance for us to do. Some of the stuff that, you know, we're going through, when we get bogged down in the nitty-gritty of life and we feel like we're going through the mud and we're just like, will this ever end? And we want to say concretely, determinatively, if that's a word, that yes, it will end. It will end with a trumpet blast when the dead in Christ will rise and we will see him, we'll meet him as he is and we'll be like him. There's an eternal perspective for those who are in Christ Jesus. There's an eternity that if we keep in our lives front and centre, it changes the way we walk. Karl Barth, the Swiss theologian, said this: Christianity that is not wholly eschatological has nothing to do with Christ. That word eschatological is future orientated. It's orientated towards our future hope in Christ. And if Christianity is not fully orientated towards our future hope in Christ, it's got nothing to do with Christ, because that's why Christ came, to raise us to a new life with him. Now, I want to shift gears. I'm going to start to bring this down to land, I promise. But I just want to shift gears very briefly. Because a leader without followers is just a person taking a walk. And actually, as much as this is about Wayne today, and as much as this is about Gary and your new leaders in Billericay Church, and so excited for the new day that God is doing and the new things that God is doing among you, actually, I just want to talk to you, particularly Billericay Baptist Church, for a moment. Daniel Aylshare said this: leadership is not a function of community, not of individuals. A violinist playing a solo does not need a conductor, but an orchestra playing a symphony does. Leadership is necessary when the task to be completed is attainable only by the work of a community. And that's what you are. The literature I've seen on leadership focuses a great deal on the attributes, skills, and characteristics of leaders. And it's important that we do that. But these are very important. But attention also needs to be given to the vocation of the community. The community's responsibility for nurturing leaders and the community's responsibility to function as a leadable ensemble. You see, we rightly focus, I think, today on the call and responsibility of Wayne. But I also want to talk to you, Billericay Baptist Church, about how you can best support Wayne. Because one of the things that I think has troubled me when I read these wonderful words in 2 Timothy and about Timothy's leadership and pastoring of the church in Ephesus is that it was only a few short years after that that Jesus says to the church in Ephesus, "Oh, how far you have fallen." This church that Timothy was called to be a pastor of, we read this in Revelation chapter 2, "You have forsaken the love that you had at first." You know, we've seen already Ephesus was a hard place to be a Christian. It's a hard place to stand up for the truth of the gospel. It's a hard place to stand up for Christ. And they're working so hard. They've withstood false teachers. They're doing so many good things. And yet, Jesus says to that church, "Repent. You've forsaken the love that you had at first." They'd been holding on to the truth. They'd been persevering. But they'd become a little bit perhaps like the older son in the parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15, who, though he'd been doing all the right things, he hadn't really, he'd kind of lost love of the father and lost love of his brother. At times over the coming months, years, however long Wayne is here, he's going to need you to fill in rotas. He's going to need you to serve on kids teams, coffee teams, not just him, but the wider church. That's how churches work. This is what you are called to do as Billericay Baptist Church. But the most important thing you can do for your church leaders is to cultivate your own heart before God, to remember your first love, that it's to Him. It's about love, that it's loving the Father and it's loving others. It's not just going through the motions. It's not just, holding to truthful things. It's not just agreeing with Him when He preaches a good sermon. It's not just serving on the coffee roast. It's not just doing these things. It's, do you love Jesus? And this is your number one call as a church that Wayne is here to help you today. So as we kind of bring this down to land, this is, I think, the hope and prayer that I have for you today. For not just for Wayne as he's being inducted today, but also for you as a church that, you know, you look to your calling, however you have defined that, however God has revealed that to you. You remember that. Remember your first call is to love Jesus. You look to the gospel. Remember the absolute importance. That you keep coming back to that source of living water, that well of the gospel. And that you look to the future. Remember, it's all about loving Jesus and loving others. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for this day and what a beautiful, wonderful day this is. We do thank you that we can gather here together to support Wayne and Gemma and Kezia and Ruben, Lord, as they take this step and walk and step into all that you have for them. We do thank you and praise you for that. Lord, I pray for every one of us here today that you would remind us afresh of the beauty of the gospel, that by your Spirit we would see clearly with grace and truth, that we've been reconciled to you through Christ. That we would live and walk in the good of that. Oh Lord, we pray that while with so many things seeking to divert and distract us, that we would see clearly what you are saying to us and that we would walk in it. Lord, that we would look to our calling, look to the gospel, look to the future. And Father, I pray for those of us who have made Christianity into a religious function, for some of us, it so easily becomes something that is dry. I believe the right things, I do the right things, but I've lost the love. Lord, I pray that by your Spirit, you would reignite in our hearts today a love for you, a love for others that goes beyond understanding. Oh, Holy Spirit, we pray, come and ignite us afresh today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. So let us stand and sing our closing song before Wayne comes to do the blessing at the end. Let's stand and sing.
Jesus, my Redeemer, there is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness.
Now the bit you've all been waiting for, the sandwiches and sausage rolls and the cake. Just before I close in prayer, just as I was, Bernard was going to come up, but I'll just do it, Bernard, if that's all right. We've got refreshments for everybody afterwards. They're in the back room downstairs and in the back room upstairs. They're the same in both. Don't feel you have to go around the bottom and round the top. If you're to go upstairs, there's only stairs. So if you're struggling to go upstairs, please go in the back and there'll be some food in there for you as well. Jem and myself will try and mingle around as many of you as possible. But if we don't get to you all, it's not because we don't like you. You understand, we'll see you tomorrow in church. Just as I close with a blessing, one thing as we were singing that song that just popped into my head. Two people I haven't thanked, and that's my mum and dad who are in glory. Yeah. And have been in glory for a long time. Yeah. And they forced my sister and I to go to Sunday school. Yeah. And we didn't want to go, but they forced us to go. And I believe with all my heart, without that, I may not be stood before you tonight. So I want to give thanks to them as well. Let's pray together. Father, we pray a simple grace. Thank you for this food and for each other. Amen. Amen. And we pray that the Lord, I pray the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. May his favor be upon you and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you, because he know this is for you. And in the morning and in the evening, in your coming and in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, know above all else that God is for you. Friends, may you know this, and may this be true for you, not just today, but always. Thank you for everybody that has taken part. Thank you, God, for the way in which you've weaved your hand throughout this service. We give you blessing, we give you honor, and we give you all the glory. Amen.